His feet steadied upon finite things. His veins can dare to cross the infinite. So suddenly the lines have become lyrical. You can see from, you see, this is a plain narrative statement. It knows itself and in itself it lives. It moves where no thought is nor any form. It's a kind of a plain narrative statement. But then his feet steadied upon finite time. His veins can dare to cross the infinite. Suddenly the breath is of a different quality altogether. Suddenly the inspiration is of a different type altogether. Arriving into his skin, a wonder space of great and marvelous meeting called he steps. So this space is calling him Ashwapati, here, Ashwapati. Of great and marvelous meeting called he steps, where thought leaned on a vision beyond thought. So beyond thought is the vision, revelation. Beyond thought is revelation, vision, sight, where thought lay on a vision beyond thought and saved a world from the unthinkable. You cannot conceive of him, you cannot think of him, unthinkable. It is that vision which is shaping the world, you see. On peaks, imagination cannot trade. On peaks, imagination cannot trade. Peaks where the imagination cannot go. In the horizons of a tireless sight, under a blue veil of eternity, the splendors of the ideal mind were seen. Splendors of ideal mind were seen. So where is he leading to now? We are going to have the description of ideal mind. We are going to have now first the description of ideal mind. Beyond where thought leaned on vision, it is there you are going to see the ideal mind. Now he talks of ideal mind. Ideal, well, kind of a perfect mind, but it is not real idea. It is idea. It is not real ideal mind. Mind, where seen, outstretched across the boundaries of things known. On peaks, imagination cannot, you cannot even imagine, you cannot go to those high peaks, you see. So, he has described first meaning called thought, meaning on vision. Then he talks of peaks of imagination, and then he talks of blue veil of eternity, horizon of tireless sight. It is there, the splendors of ideal mind are seen. Now this blue is actually the typical color of the spiritual mind. Blue is the color of spiritual mind. Under a blue veil of eternity, the splendors of ideal mind were seen, outstretched across the boundaries of things known. Under, trochee, a blue, I am veil of trochee, ether, I am niti, pirik. So you got trochee, I am pirik, you see. It goes on like that. Under a blue veil of eternity, you see. very peculiar line, you see. The splendors of ideal mind were seen. Outstretched.
What is this ideal mind?
Ideal.
Supermind?
No.
Overmind.
Not even. Well, you can say up to a certain extent overmind. Overmind. Actually, overmind to a certain, yeah. You can say that. Yeah. Blue veil of eternity, overmind, yeah. But he is now still climbing up, where he is going beyond thought, going vision. Well, you can say almost up to overmind.
Below
ideal mind. That's the idea.
Almost overmind. Not yet. It's almost
overmind.
It's not yet.
Not supermind at all.
No. Ideal mind is below overmind.
Below overmind.
Okay.
I will say that.
Just
to have an idea.
Yes.
Don't go too fast.
The splendors of ideal mind were seen. Origin of the little that we instinct with the endless more that we must be a prop of all that human strength enacts. Creator of hopes by earth, unrealized hopes unrealized by earth, but they are creating. So that is the kind of an over mind, ideal mind is describing this union. It spreads beyond expanding universe. It's wing beyond the boundaries of dream. It wing beyond the boundaries of dream. Boundaries of dream. So swapna, dream. Swapna is the consciousness. First we got jagrata, then we got swapna, then we got sushupti, and then we got turiya. The four stages of consciousness is in swapna. Swapna, you see, jagrata, what you see all around here, the waking consciousness, jagrata. Waking means, actually, these are the four states of the Supreme Being Himself. Jagrata, swapna, sushupti, and turiya. They are the four stages of the Supreme Being Himself. Virat, Vaishvanara. He is present everywhere, that is the jagrata. Then he is kind of dreaming, trying to bring out something of himself, his own dream, trying to bring out something of himself, that is the swapna, dream. Then behind Hiranyagarbha, the seed, golden seeds are there in the dream. Then you have got behind the sushupti, causal consciousness, causal consciousness, sushupti, prajna. Beyond prajna is then the unknowable, turiya, you see, cannot be described. So, it's being beyond the boundaries of dream. So, it has gone beyond Hiranyagarbha, beyond Hiranyagarbha. It overtopped the ceiling of life's soul. So, it is a very high, he is talking of the greatness of greater mind, you see, so, all the things. Awake in a luminous sphere, unbound by thought, he's crossing beyond thought, unbound by thought, exposed to omniscient immensities, it casts on our world its great crown influences. So they throw their influences, all from the ideal mind, all these influences come here, down, down, down. You can say up to a certain extent, the world of Plato's idea, the world of Plato, you have got the idea of a certain thing and then it comes down and becomes the factual thing here. You have got the idea of say writing pen up there and then it comes down, 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 it becomes a writing pen, it becomes a sketch pen, it becomes a nib, it becomes a fountain pen, it becomes a quill, you see, it becomes all those things, you see, 1,000 things like that quill. So the idea of the pen, writing thing, writing device, that's the original idea, ideal mind. And then you got the chair, a divine chair, and then you have got hundreds of types of chairs here, you see. Variety of chair, a chair for the pet, a chair for the dog, a chair for the child. All kinds of chairs are there, you see, that way. Exposed to omniscient immensity. It casts on a world its great crown influencing. Its speed that outstrips the ambling of the hour. Its speed, hour, its force that strides invincibly through time. Its mind that breaks the gulf betwixt man and God. It's a mighty thing, you see, that way, mighty. His ideal mind. He's talking of the ideal mind, it mind that bridge the gulf betwixt man and God, betwixt man and God. It's light that combat ignorance and death. It combats ignorance and death. The idea combats ignorance, but it cannot conquer. It combats, it struggles against life and death. In its vast ambit of ideal space, where it is Where beauty and mightiness walk hand in hand, the spirit to take form as living God. So how does the birth of God take place? This is what is describing. How does the God's birth take place? The spirit's truth, the ideal mind, the truth of the spirit, it is that which takes a form of a deity. You have got God of love, God of beauty, God of joy. It's an idea of beauty, idea of love, idea of power, idea of knowledge, and corresponding to that idea, you have got a form, and that form is the God, you see. So that is how the gods are born in a way, so to say, you see. The spirit's truths take form as living gods, and each can build a world of its own right, and each can build a world in its own right. Each idea then can have its own world. You have got God, you have got Durga, she will build her own world. You have got Saraswati, she will build her own world. You have got Shiva, he will build his own world. Like that, each God will have his own world. In other words, these are the formateur gods, gods who create their own type, you see, beings. So, this is actually reaching the overmind plane, formateur earth, overmind plane. The spirit is to take form as living God in the overmind, in the overmind. And each can build a world in its own, and each, I am, can build, I am, a world, and I am, in its spirit, own right, spondi, perfectly monosyllabic line. And each can build a world in its own right. In an air with doubt and error, cannot mark. There is a question of doubt and error there. Weigh the stigmata of their deformity. So, what do the doubt and error do? They bring deformity. So, there is no question of deformity there at all. Doubt and error bring deformity. There is no question of deformity. In the air which doubt and error cannot mark, with the stigmata of the deformity, in communion with the musing privacy of a truth that sees in an unerring light, where the sight falters not, nor wanders thorn, exempt from our world's exorbitant texts of tears, exempt from our world's exorbitant texts of tears, see the acceleration, exempt from our world's exorbitant texts of tears. What a line, you see, texts of tears. I made some notes here about texts of tears. Exempt, I am, from our, I am, words exhort, that is a critic, words exhort, petrant, tax, anapist, of tears, which can be amphibrac, which can be taken also as an I am. Exempt from our words exhort, petrant, tax, of tears. If you make tears disyllabic, then it is an amphibrac, last word. Exempt from our world's exorbitant tax of tears. And up here. We have got this phrase here, tax of tears. It is reminiscent of Virgil's line. Text of tears. In fact, this phrase occurs in 106.123. Text of tears equivalent. Touch of tears in mortal things. Touch of tears in mortal things. There he calls it touch of tears in mortal things. 106.123. Touch of tears in mortal things. Illiyappa? Irukai? Touch of tears in mortal thing. Too hard for us is heaven's indifference. Our own tragedies are not enough for us. All pathos and all suffering we make ours. We have sorrow for a greatness passed away and feel the touch of tears in mortal thing. Now this is the sentence put in the mouth of Malavi, Savitri's mother, queen. Savitri has chosen Satyavan for her husband, and here comes Narada and says, this fellow is going to die 1 year after marriage, and this lady is going to persuade her daughter, please give up that choice and find some other person. And it is that, in that context, she is developing all these arguments. She touch of tears in mortal thing. See, our sorrowful life is there. Why you are increasing sorrow? Give it up. Find some other person, all that thing. The touch of tears in mortal thing. So that is the phrase from Virgil directly. Touch of tears in mortal. One of the most famous lines in Virgil's composition. And here we have got stacks of tears. Well, if you want to compare this phrase, stacks of tears and touch of tears, as two phrases, stacks of tears and touch of tears. There is something very sweet about touch of tears and stacks of tears, you see. Something very nice about touch of tears. But here, stacks is important because of this ex alliteration. Exent, our voice, exorbitant, stacks of tears. XXX, 3X, very, very unusual kind of alliteration. Very unusual kind of alliteration, you see. Exent from our violence, exorbitant, text of tears. Dreaming is liberal's creation gaze on the idea that people, eternity,